Hey everyone, the name is Erik Thor, and in today's video, we are introducing the Myers-Briggs Type Indicator. And this video is for you who wants to know and understand the personality psychology, how to use it, how to apply it, how to think about it, how to approach it. You know, personality psychology is the field that studies the subjective. How do we think? How do we feel? What makes us motivated? What makes us happy? How do we work? How do we act? How do we behave? And you know, a lot of these things are almost impossible to measure objectively. We can only understand them tendentially. People do things, but what they do is often inconsistent with what they want to achieve. A lot of people do and act in ways that are counterintuitive to their motivations, their feelings, and their needs. What I've found is, with personality psychology, you can gain a greater understanding of yourself and your own motivations and feelings, and you can become better at understanding how to live and how to act in congruity with your feelings and with what you want to live a life that gives you greater happiness, flow, energy, motivation, control, and a heightened sense of inner stability. So, often I work with Myers-Briggs Type Indicator. What I believe, however, is that the Myers-Briggs Type Indicator falls into the trap of stereotypes and simple categorization systems. Simple categorization systems that are scientifically impossible, that don't hold up, that change from month to month. Every personality test you take has a chance of giving you a different result every time you take it. Now, I believe your personality type is not what your friends think about you. It's not who you act as at work. It's not who you are around your friends, but it is who you are when you are in a positive state of flow. So what I tell everyone who comes to me is, find your flow, find what gives you energy, find what motivates you, find what makes you stressed, find what makes you calm, find what gives you control, and find what you find scary. So I'm searching for and I'm trying to understand human motivation, the most subjective thing there is. Can we ever get an objective awareness of it? How can we ever know about it? The only thing we can know is whether our interpretations of ourselves can be used to make us happier. The question is, can what you realize from studying personality psychology make you a better person? Can it make you more ethical? Can it make you more happy? Can it make you feel better about your life? Can it give some psychological value? And I believe that personality psychology, when used correctly, can do all these things. Now, I believe personality should first be understood through four dichotomies, first keyed by Carl Jung. These dichotomies are introversion, intuition, feeling, judging. They are extroversion, sensing, thinking, and perceiving. So introversion is often put against extroversion, intuition against sensing, feeling against thinking, judging against perceiving. Introversion is a person who gains a sense of calm and stability on their own while thinking about something, while developing some kind of inner idea or definition for something, while theorizing or questioning something philosophically, while introspecting on something and reflecting on its value to the self. The extrovert, on the other hand, is a person that gets a sense of stability while connecting dots and patterns in the world around them, figuring things out by observing clues and hidden riddles in the world around them. The extrovert is a person that gets stability from experiences, being somewhere, seeing something, having been there, having done it, having been through it. The extrovert searches for experience, for data, for facts around them that can back up their awareness and give them a sense of security and confidence. The extrovert searches for assurance socially, morally, in what they do and how they act and how they behave. So the introvert has an internal sense of self, where the extrovert has an externalized sense of self. So the extrovert's idea and awareness of the world around them comes from their inner thoughts about the world around them. The extrovert is constantly observing the world, assessing the world, thinking about the world, what people say, what they do, why they say it, where they come from, where they're going, where they're headed. The introvert, from going inside, thinking about something, developing an idea about something, researching something, and coming up with some kind of internal framework for it. Intuition is often put against sensing. Intuition and sensing refer to two different interests or hobbies, two different ways to get energy and motivation or a sense of interest or heightened stimulation. So when we go into intuition, we can find ourselves going towards or exploring some kind of a vision or a vague or abstract idea or some kind of intellectual project. The intuitive can fall into searching for hidden puzzles. They like thinking or theorizing about the world. They like formulating some kind of conclusion about what's happening around them using pattern recognition, logic, or abstract data. The intuitive mind is all about filling in the dots, thinking about the unknown, understanding what we cannot know for sure, speculating about something, coming up with different alternative hypotheses about something. The sensor, on the other hand, focuses on things that are, in their nature, based in experience, having seen something, having been somewhere, having done something, having tried something out, having held it in your hands, having looked at it, having studied it, having gathered data from it. The sensor is searching for and draws energy and stimulation from being somewhere where things are happening, where there are things going on, where there's action, where you can be spontaneous, where you can exercise physical control, where you can organize things, where you can host events, where you can do things. The sensor is looking for things to do, things that are concrete, tangible, practical in their nature. The feeling and the thinking types are described as different sources of motivation or passion. So they often bring us some kind of feeling of pride or some kind of feeling of satisfaction because we have done the right thing or what we think is good or what we think is meaningful. So feeling and thinking has to do with where we search for meaning. And feelers, they search for meaning in nuances and quality. Feelers look for and try to reach some kind of emotional goal or some kind of emotional reward in every situation. So what they're doing is they're looking for ways to be honest, to express themselves, ways to say to something, ways to influence the community, ways to connect with other people, ways to build relationships, ways to understand others or themselves. The feeler is looking to understand their emotional life, to understand their feelings, to adjust their feelings, to manage and process their feelings, to gain some kind of understanding towards self and towards social and organic concepts. So the feeling type is looking for things that have to do with community, things that have to do with communication, things that have to do with listening, with understanding and thinking about and processing other people's experiences and thinking about what you've done and what it felt like, where you were, what you liked about it, what you didn't like about it. The thinking type searches for meaning in quantitative, productive, and more focused approaches. They focus on their thinking, how they define things, how they understand things logically, what they think is a strategic or realistic way to achieve something. So the thinker looks for and formulates goals and tasks and develops tools that can help them reach some kind of emotional goal. So the hope of the thinking type is that through working at something, developing a skill, improving a tool, or coming up with a plan, they can reach emotional goals of pride and satisfaction by achieving something, by setting up an ambition, by coming up with a project, by organizing a project, by developing a new skill, by learning or honing your ability at something, by testing yourself, scoring yourself, rating yourself, scale 1 to 10. Finding ways to do things better and better and better. Judging and perceiving, finally, the fourth dichotomy is all about control. So when you use perceiving, what you're looking at is adaptation. When you use judging, you're looking at goals. So perceiving is all about what we do in response to what's happening around us. We see something coming up, or we come up with or think about what could happen next. Perceiving is about predicting short-term changes or anticipating or responding to various actions and activities around us. So the perceiving type is focused on smart ways to resolve problems that come up around them. They are thinking about, what would I do if this happened? How would I respond if this came up? What would I do now if this is going to happen? So perceivers, they focus on short-term control and on short-term goals and rewards. There is something right next there behind the door that I could get if I did this or that or that. Perceivers look at changes from week to week and opportunities from that are coming up every day, every week, every month, looking at what we can do right now to make our situation better. The judging type finally focuses on long-term strategies to reach their goals and to deal with their problems. The judger thinks, what can I do? How can I do it? How can I get it done? What are my goals? How do I get there? What is my strategy? What is my long-term approach to dealing with these situations? What code of conduct should I have when dealing with these situations? How should I look at them? Judging focuses on the whole, perceiving focuses on the parts. So perceiving sees different individuals, different people, different tools, different methods, where judging sees different strategies, different groups, different communities. So judging is in many ways oriented towards the bigger picture, whereas perceiving is oriented towards the different possibilities that are constantly coming up in every situation. What you'll find is perceivers get a relief of stress, a sense of relief of stress, when they are able to reach short-term rewards and to deal with short-term problems that can come up or that could occur. Judgers are stressed by dealing with these problems. They feel distracted by them. They feel it is an interruption towards their long-term goal. So the judger feels relief when they are able to have a strategy or a long-term plan that they can devote themselves on, focus on, that will get them where they need to go. Now I get that all of these things sound complicated, vague, difficult, hard to understand. They are too nuanced. What do they mean? How do I use it in reality? So what I'm going to do to you first is I'm going to show you four different personality types. And I'm going to talk about the ISTJ, the ESTP, the INFP, and the ENFJ. Now, these are all four different personality types, and they have combinations of different personality traits that we mentioned already. The ISTJ is introverted, the ESTP is extroverted, the INFP is intuitive, the ISTJ is sensing, the ESTP is perceiving, the ENFJ is judging. So these are all different personality traits. These are all different approaches to different things. Now, if you want to understand it in a simplified manner, you could say the ISTJ is the pinnacle of steadiness and of control and principle and discipline and organization. The ISTJ is symbolized by the calm and structured and steady green. It's symbolized by earth. It's symbolized by things we can rely on and hold on to. Blue, on the other hand, is symbolized best by the idea of conscience, of having a conscience, of having feelings about something, of reflecting on something, of introspecting on something, of processing something, thinking about it philosophically, existentially. Why are we here? Why do we do what we do? The ESTP is the idea of, and represents the idea of influence in society, the ability to get your voice heard, the ability to take control of your environment, to make a name for yourself, to become friends with the people around you, to get respect from other people, the ability to prove yourself, to compete with others, to get recognition for what you do. The ESTP is the most influential type in society, the person that the most easily gets a say in society's matters. The ENFJ is and represents the idea of passion and dominance and of the ability to have strong outward emotions, to focus on something and work towards something, to put all your emotions into it, to be passionate about something, to go and give it your all, to put something, to put yourself towards an intellectual goal or a vision, to put yourself out there for the people, to be there and to speak out for the community. These are all four different personality types, and they show very stark contrast to one another. You go to the ISTJ because they make you feel secure, because they know the protocols, they know the rules, they know the right way and order to do things. You go to the ENFJ because they know how to get the vision done, how to fight for what can sound sometimes impossible. You go to the INFP because you don't know what's right or wrong anymore. And maybe the INFP, with their introspective gifts and abilities, can help give some kind of understanding and clarity and insight. When you look at it in total, there are 16 different personality types: the ISTJ, the ISFJ, the ISFP, the ISTP, all different variations, all different concepts, all different personality traits. None of these are like the other. Everyone is different in different ways, but there are similarities and connections between each of them. Often what you can find is most people don't have a steady position in that those four previously mentioned concepts. The ISTP can be steady and has some steady traits, but it can also be influential and also knows how to get the word in and how to have a say for themselves. The INFJ has some of the conscience of the INFP, but also gets caught up in their passion for their visions and for their ideas, sometimes rushing ahead or putting themselves out there for what they believe in. The ENTJ has some of the domination and ability to push forward and to put yourself into something that can sound sometimes crazy, but they also have the ability to be easygoing and to be charming and to get an influence and to get a say and respect in what they do, similar to the ESTP. Now, most of these types are a mix of different traits. So which one are you? Which one do you fit at? Which traits do you connect with the most? Steadiness, dominance, influence, or conscience? If you look at a single personality type like the INFJ, what you notice is they have different combinations of different letters. You can pick them apart saying the INFJ has introverted intuition. You can also pick them apart saying they have feeling and judging. You can pick them apart and say they have intuition and judging. You can pick them apart and say they have introversion and feeling. And introversion and feeling, that's what makes an INFJ introspective. Intuition and judging, that is what makes the INFJ called towards being a visionary. Feeling and judging, that's what gives the INFJ a sense of community. Introverted intuition is what gives the INFJ a sense of philosophy or existential outlook on life. So the INFJ has the conscience of the INFP in that they are introspective and that they are philosophical, but they also have the visionary traits of the ENFJ, along with the desire to work for and to make an impact on the community. There are in total 16 of these combinational traits, 16 different what I call cognitive functions. Carl Jung, he worked with 8, but I started expanding it towards 16 because I wanted to provide extra nuance into each personality type. Each cognitive function can be symbolized by a different color and by a different symbol. The squares, they represent our ability to map and organize and understand our surroundings, to categorize things, to organize things, to have focus, to have an ability to understand what's happening here and now in this moment, to the ability to intercept and understand different options and opportunities that lay present before us. The circle types, they are associated with strong observation and the ability to gain perception and awareness and insight into things. What is happening around us? What has happened in the past? What could happen next? And how do we know? Why are we here? What do we do? Why are we doing it? The triangles represent our ability to make decisions and to set our mind on something. Who am I? Who are the people around me? What do they want? What do I want? What is happening around me? What data can I get from my surroundings? What results can I get in this moment? What could I achieve in this situation? What could I do, logically speaking, rationally speaking? What could I achieve in this moment, or what could I understand about the world on a rational level? The stars finally relate to our ability to measure and understand our situation. Am I being honest with myself? Am I being a good person? Am I being generous? Am I skilled at what I do? Am I doing good at what I do? It also explains, am I getting towards my ambition or towards my goals and towards my projects? How well am I reaching my goals and the stepping stones that I've set before me? Combining these things, the map types represent our ability to decide on and control our understanding and our perception about things, to make up our mind on something, how to think about something, how it looks, how it appears, how to understand it. Where the circle, there our perception, our observation, helps us gain awareness into things. What is actually happening? What is actually going on? What is it actually that I could do? What is my potential? When you understand your cognitive functions, you can understand a lot of things about how you make decisions, what decision to make, how to make it, how to get there. You can also highlight blind spots you might have in your own behavior, and you can intercept when you're being unable to act or respond to your different cognitive needs and emotional needs. My goal is to take a holistic outlook on all the personality types and flow types. I want to understand all different personality psychology systems. I want to understand MBTI. I want to understand social psychology. I want to understand Maslow's different hierarchies of needs. I want to understand the Enneagram, the Big Five, DISC, color psychology. I want to understand socionics. I want to look at neuroscience, genetics, data, and statistics. I want to develop accurate personality tests, and I want to use everything I learned to get a bigger awareness and more ideas for how to help you have more flow in your life, better relationships, and more success in your goals and your ambitions. So if you like this video, if you want to support me in this, visit patreon.com/erikthor, like, subscribe, and leave a comment on this video, perhaps share it with your friends. Thanks everyone for joining up, and I hope this video can help you be introduced to my systems, my theories, my ideas. Let me know if there is anything you thought was different from what you're used to. Let me tell you, tell me if there's something I should be looking at that I haven't looked at yet. Let me tell you if there's a personality type you want to learn more about, if there's something you want me to do. Just let me know in the comments down below. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you all in the next video.